Welcome back to Meet the Coach. I'm Pat Curran, one of the co-founders here at our coaching network. Today, we've got Ty Taylor. He's the defensive line coach and recruiting coordinator at Pleasant Grove High School. And he's also the host of Keep Your Pads Down podcast. Ty, thank you for joining us.
Thanks so much. I appreciate it. Glad to be here.
Of course. Of course. We connected a few weeks back. And I said, we got to do one of these so we can get to know you a little bit better from a public sense after our first conversation. So first of all, tell us how you got into coaching, period. And we'll go from there.
Yeah, so I wasn't one of those guys that grew up always knowing I wanted to coach football. I loved football. Played from the time I was in fourth grade and was just always around it and always drawn to the sport. And I think, you know, somewhere sophomore year of college decided that that's what I wanted to do. And so got in it that way and started out. My wife, we knew she was going to have to go to grad school for her job. She's a speech therapist. And so I said, well, you just pick somewhere where you want to go, and I'll get a coaching job there. And so she wound up at Ole Miss there in Oxford. And so I kind of threw a long, winding road, wound up at a high school there and volunteered my first year. I tutored at Ole Miss, tutored football players at Ole Miss by day. And by afternoon, I volunteer coached for them that first year and then got on full time the next year and spent 4 years there and had a great run there. And then moved back to Texas, where I'm from, to Kerrville, which is hill country, about 50 miles west of San Antonio. It's home of Johnny Manziel. That's what
heard of that guy.
What most people know it for, if they're familiar with the football there. But I was there for 6 years as the defensive line coach and special teams coordinator, and then had the opportunity to come up here to Texarkana, to Pleasant Grove. And so now I've been here 2 years.
Were you did you play defensive line? What your position did you play?
Yeah, I did. I played defensive end at a Division II school called Harding University there in Searcy, Arkansas.
Yeah.
And was very, 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 very average player. But the experiences there did a lot for me as far as, you know, just building some resiliency and mental toughness, and also just built some and formed some great relationships that I still draw on today. So I'm very thankful for that experience.
Sure. So my favorite question to ask on here is, who as a coach, who is the person you look up to, whether that's an actual coach or a parent or someone around, who inspires you as a leader?
Yeah. So this is I'm glad you asked this question, because, and this is not a plug for my podcast, but I actually got to interview.
Plug away. Plug away.
I got to interview a guy who was my defensive coordinator in high school. And he's a head coach. He's been a head coach at a school down in Southeast Texas, and they've won a couple of state championships and played for four of them, and got to interview him for my own podcast. And that episode is out this week, actually. And he was a huge influence on me. And then also, this is got a text today from my old high school head coach who said he's going to be driving through Texarkana tomorrow and wanted to stop by and see me. And so that made me feel like a kid again. And so both of those guys really had a lot to do with me wanting to become a football coach. I didn't know it at the time when I was playing for them, but, you know, once I started thinking back and really trying to go through my mind if that's what I wanted to do, I thought about those two guys and the impact that they had on me and the influence that they had on me. And so those two guys were definite influences as far as wanting to become a coach. And then as far as just being a leader, two other men that come to mind are my dad, who always was there to support me, and he didn't play sports, so really he was a military brat, moved around a lot, and so but he was always very supportive of me and my brothers and my sister and whatever we decided to do, and has always been there for advice, offered me advice. And then actually his dad, my granddad, who is he's 96 years old and actually in the hospital with COVID, but I think he's gonna be okay. But he's a retired Marine general and one of the toughest men that I know. And so those four guys are all guys who have influenced me as a man and as a coach.
Love that. So switching gears to the podcast. So just tell us a little bit about the podcast and why you even started it. Because I'm a podcast guy. I love podcasts. I think the opportunity for coaches to start podcasts is obviously there's podcasts out there and they're starting to grow. But to me, the opportunity is massive to grow not only for your brand, but to talk and network and create opportunities long term.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm a big fan of podcasts also. I'm listening to them all the time. You know, even if I'm driving to work or I'm out doing yard work or working out, I usually listen to podcasts, and I like a bunch of, you know, there's a bunch of different kinds of podcasts that I like, not just coaching podcasts, but this was a few summers ago. I was listening to there are a couple of different football podcasts that I checked out routinely. And the one thing that kind of left me unsatisfied was the fact that how little of content there was out there devoted to defensive line play, even just defensive play. I mean, I think when you look at the proportion of offense versus defense, it's heavily favored for the offense, which I get it. Sometimes defensive coaches can be a little leery about giving away secrets and things like that, but there just didn't seem like there was as many resources out there for defensive coaches and even more so defensive line coaches. So up to that point, I had written some articles and done some writing and things like that. And that was getting a little bit stale because, you know, I like what we're doing now, talking with people and making connections and getting to know people. And so that appealed to me. And so I started a podcast in March of 2000 or February of 2019, I guess, and had no idea how to start a podcast and what all that entailed. And some might argue that I still don't. But it's been a great ride and journey so far. And I've met, you know, people ask, you know, why do you do that? You know, what's the draw for you? And to me, it's the relationships that I've made. You know, I have a phone full of outstanding coaches that I can text or call or hit up for advice. And so that's been really, really invaluable.
Yeah, scrolling through the list of all the coaches, and it's like, I mean, like I said, it's a such a great relationship builder, networking opportunity. I don't think you're a guy who's looking to jump jobs and do that kind of thing. You seem pretty comfortable where you are. But for other coaches that I've talked to, it's like, if you're not going out and networking with coaches, how do you expect to be getting different jobs? You know, in this world, you're getting a job more than likely based on you either know somebody specifically or you know somebody who knows somebody. So if that's the move, have conversations. And it doesn't need to be a hey, I'm looking to like help me with something. It can just be a natural conversation like a podcast, and you're building a relationship long term from that. I'm sure those guys, the dozens of guys you've had on there now, you can reach back out anytime and say, hey coach, I saw you guys did this or heard you something happened in the game, and you're continuing to you know, actually have a real relationship behind it too.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the thing. I think if you get into it with the idea of, all right, I'm going to use this to launch into a, you know, to get a D1 coaching job or something like that, then I think it's going to flare out pretty quick. But I think if you're looking at it just to build genuine relationships, then if something like that happens, like a, you know, someone you that you made a connection with has a job open up or they hear of something, that's gravy. I think the real benefit is building those relationships and having those, like you said, those guys that you can call up or text. I mean, I would say that I bet that I know that there's not a week that goes by that I don't text or maybe call or have some sort of interaction with a coach that I've had on a podcast. And then all the time when we're talking in our own office, talking about scheme or things that we might want to do, I try not to be this guy, but I find myself referencing conversations that I had with coaches on my podcast. Because it's valuable stuff, and it's just it's another way. It's an enjoyable way for me to continue to learn and stay current and stay sharp.
Yeah, and I know you're not just defensive line coaches anymore. Yeah. How many? When did you start to shift? How many? The first? How many were just defensive? We're only talking D line stuff.
And then yeah. I think I always wanted it to be, you know, be D line centric, but then also have some guys on that weren't strictly defensive line coaches, because that can get stale pretty quick. And I'm one of those guys, I get bored easily. So, you know, I always try to have, like, if I'm going to have a month of episodes, so if there's 4 to 5 episodes, you know, maybe 3 be defensive line coaches and 2 not, or, you know, maybe 2 and 2. We have some episodes planned for this spring semester that I'm really excited about that won't be D-line coaches that I think guys will enjoy. And it's, if they're not a defensive line coach, I try to make sure that their message or what they're bringing to the table is going to add some value to those guys who would also listen on any other given week.
Yeah. I saw you had Coach Jeremy Hawkins from Eastern Kentucky on a recent episode. We just had him. He just did a clinic last week. I'm sure there's more collabs and some things we can try to arrange on our end. If you had one coach that you could work with that you've never worked with before, who would you have and why?
So a coach that was on my podcast or just any
coach? No, a coach to work with.
Okay.
Any coach. I've got, you know what? Let's start on the podcast. Screw it. Same type of vibe. If there's a guy that you're like, shit, who would be great to have, never talked to, never done anything with?
Now, there's a bunch of dudes. And so, I mean, we've had 92 episodes recorded. Okay. So that's a lot of guys, including my own brothers. And they've been on, and guys that I work with currently. So I'm going to throw those guys out. But one guy who's been getting a lot of love on, you know, if you guys who are listening to this, if you tune into Football Scoop, like most football coaches do, you watch Football Scoop or you've seen that lately, a guy that's really blown up is Randall Joyner, who just got, he was the defensive line coach at SMU and now he's at Ole Miss. He was a guy that, you know, that I don't remember how we got put in touch for our podcast, but he was actually a guy that I really didn't know at all. And within about 2 minutes of talking to him, I could tell this dude was legit. And that happens a lot. And those are the best episodes when, you know, you start talking to someone and immediately you can tell, yeah, this dude's got it. This dude's got some juice. This dude knows what he's talking about. And so I guess with Coach Joyner, what stuck out to him was how detail oriented he was and how passionate he was. You know, he can go through his coaching progression through his sleep. And so I just think, and the way that he teaches pass rush is kind of from the Ohio State Larry Johnson school of thinking, which is one that is fairly new to me and that I would like to learn more about. And so he would be a guy that I think, because he does some things a little bit differently than what I've done in the past, that I think would be great to work with, because I think I'd learn a lot from him.
Got you. Love that. Would be a great guy. I totally, when you said that, I was just thinking, we just got off Nick Cardwell, who's the App State O-line coach. I told you, so this is, what night is tonight? Wednesday night. I'll put it, this will be up tomorrow. But so we just got done with Nick Cardwell. He just did a wide zone clinic. And like 30 seconds in, I'm sitting there like, oh, this is going to be good. You know, I know this guy's going to be great and dynamic. And then 60 minute plus, it was just like, bop, 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 dynamic quality stuff throughout. All right, I'll get you out on this one. Last one. What would you tell, if you had one piece of advice to give younger coach Ty Taylor, what would you give him?
Oh, that's a great question. I think when I first.
How old are you right now?
I'm 35.
Okay. All right. So let's talk 35. To young. Let's talk to like 20. You said sophomore year. So you're 21. You're like, I think I'm going to try to coach. What am I going to do here? What advice would you give that young man?
I would say this is kind of a common, I guess this is a common phrase that kids say today, but say less. And it would be, man, don't yell so much. And instead of trying to, go all in on being like the authoritarian figure with those kids and like, I'm the coach and you're going to do what I say because I'm the coach. And I think that go all in on building the relationships with them. And that doesn't mean like, you know, do everything you can to make the kids like you, but, you know, still coach them hard. But I think that I didn't understand, because I was a kid that just did whatever a coach said because he was the coach. I didn't understand it when my players didn't respond that way. And my natural inclination was to yell and scream or get flustered and really get bent out of shape about it, instead of trying to figure out how to reach that kid and take another approach. And so I think that would be it. It would be to really go all in on the relationship aspect of coaching, and then to learn as much as I can. I think I did a pretty good job of that part. And a lot of it was because I was fortunate to break in with some coaches who did a really good job of taking me under their wing and having a lot of patience with me. But that would be the thing would be to really focus on building relationships with the guys that I'm coaching.
Love that. Great stuff. Coach, we appreciate you jumping on here on Meet the Coach, and we're excited to have you on our coaching network. Thank you.
Absolutely. I'm excited. Thank you so much for having me, Patrick.